Hello and welcome to our latest Insider interview. Today I have with me Jacob de Tusch-Lec, who is fund manager of the Artemis Monthly Distribution Fund. Jacob, thanks for coming in today.
Thank you for having me.
So Jacob, the fund invests in both equities and bonds. What is the typical split? And I also understand that you've been recently reducing exposure to equities.
Yeah, so the bond component is sort of usually between 50 and 55%. And we don't tend to move it around a lot. There is an asset allocation exercise to be done. And as you point to, recently we've been taking equities down because bonds are yielding again after almost a decade of not yielding. So now we can actually get income from the bond side, which is great. There are some side effects, but we can talk about those later. But it's great that we can get income from the bond side of the portfolio. So we've increased that. And you could argue that the bar has increased for the equities, because now we need to get a proper yield there. What we can do, though, is not just move around the equity bond allocation, but within equities, we can, for example, decide to buy more listed infrastructure. And that has bond-like characteristics. We can decide to maybe buy some mortgage REITs or some apartment REITs, so get some real estate backing in there. So it's not just about bonds and equities. It's also what kind of equities do we have and what kind of asset classes are sitting supporting those equities.
And in providing a monthly income to investors, do you have to be strategic about when the income is paid by the shares and the bonds?
We do look at ex-dividend dates. For example, in Europe, companies pay dividends once a year. It'd be a bit silly to hold a stock for 11 months and then sell it the day before you get the dividend. But broadly speaking, the dividend is sort of part of the investment process. So the idea is that we hold the right stocks at the right time. We will ultimately end up collecting enough income to pass on to clients. But the total return is important as well. So we're not going to hold a stock for 2 months just because the dividend is coming in 2 months' time. The investment universe is big enough for us. It's a global remit, both for the bonds and the equities. So you can always go somewhere and get some income. We tend to sort of sweep up income as we go along, but it is quite lumpy for the end client.
You mentioned that the income is lumpy. So how does it work in practice? How does the fund pay the monthly income?
It's not smoothed. It's sort of a bit, what do we have to deliver? We can smooth a bit, but ultimately, this is an instrument we expect clients to hold for the longer term. And also many clients hold accumulation shares, so they don't actually get the dividend paid out. So we try not to tinker too much with it and just say, we're investing in companies that pay a high dividend yield. We're investing in bonds that give you a nice income, and we give you a bit of asset allocation.
Year to date, it's been a very challenging period for both equity and bond markets. And with bonds, they've not provided the same level of protection as they have done historically when stock markets have fallen. So what's your view on the bond market sell-off? Has it been overdone, or is there more to come? And just to give our listeners some context, I am asking this question on the day that sterling has hit a record low against the US dollar.
So you're right, it's been very challenging for bonds because we've seen rates go up the most it has for decades. Inflation is at multi-decade high. And volatility is very high as well. And this sort of usual diversification you get, you know, when equities go down, bonds go up because rates go down. And there is this sort of diversification effect. We haven't really seen that this year. And more importantly, actually, some bond funds have gone down more than equities, which is not usually what you would expect when equities are down. So you could argue the beta is much higher on the bonds than you would expect. And that's challenging. I don't think it's entirely surprising, because that's what happens when central banks raise rates and you have inflation, is financial assets go down. And bonds might be safe, but they are financial assets. And they got very expensive after a decade of very low rates. So again, what we try to do is just to say, where are the sweet spots within each asset class? Where do we think we're getting enough income for the risk we're taking? And although we don't get the full diversification effect that we would in a normal year, we are getting some, because at least we're spreading the risks as much as we can.
As you mentioned earlier, the silver lining to the bond market sell-off is that bond yields are at the most attractive levels they have been for several years. As a result of this, does this mean that the income being generated by the fund will increase in the years to come?
There are a lot of moving parts behind the scenes, and one of them is currency. And obviously we're going through a time now where sterling is depreciating. So for the equities that are held in non-sterling currencies, giving you an income diversified away from sterling, that gives us a bit more growth because per definition, you're collecting $1 here, €1 here. Well, they just gotten X percent more valuable in sterling. The same with some of the bonds that you're getting a coupon in a different currency. There is some hedging on that side in order to avoid too much currency volatility. But broadly speaking, sterling weakness is a positive for us because we're getting these overseas income. On the bond side, yes, your entry point is such that you're getting a higher yield. But of course, if inflation continues at these pretty high levels, and I would say I don't think that will be the case, but it's also not going to come down to 2% anytime soon. So we're going to be at a higher level than we've gotten used to. Our entry point on the bond side is, yes, you're getting a nice income compared to inflation. But of course, these are fixed coupons. They don't grow over time. That's where the attraction of equities come in, because the equity side, we hope we can grow the dividend anywhere between 3 and 8%, assuming the currency is fixed. And that gives you a little bit of inflation protection on the equity side. The objective of the fund is in the medium term to grow the dividend in sterling, irrespective of what the currency does. So hopefully, by having a better entry point on the bond side and higher dividend growth on the equity side, overall the income should grow over time.
And among the equity holdings, I understand there's a focus on defensive businesses. Could you explain the key qualities that you look for in a company and give us a couple of stock examples?
What we try to do is to look for companies where the dividend is high. So the starting point is a high dividend, let's say 5%, for example, where we think that dividend is underpinned by the free cash flow generation of the business. So no funnies, no asset sales, not, you know, actual cash generated by the underlying business on a day-to-day basis. And then we look at the balance sheet. We don't want balance sheets to be incredibly stretched, because when rates go up, spreads go up, cost of lending goes up, the dividend is at risk. So we try also to sort of look for companies without too much debt. And that tends to put us into what I would call rather boring sectors, but boring is good in this instance. So the fund tends to have a lot of exposure to pharmaceuticals, utilities, so maybe concession businesses like toll roads, bridges, etc. As it happens now, we also have exposure to commodities, a larger extent than usual, because we think when inflation is high, you want to have some assets underpinning it. So the umbrella I would put around a lot of our exposure is around asset backing. So in a world where you have inflation, you want to have some tangible assets. And a lot of the exposure in the fund, although it's in different sectors, the common denominator is that you have some assets in the ground or above ground underpinning those cash flows. I could mention Avalon Bay, which is the biggest apartment REIT in the US, or the biggest listed one. And they have a fair amount of debt, but they can raise their rents. Every time a tenant moves out, new tenant moves in, rents go up. And that should offset the higher funding cost that they have, but also inflation. So that's a stock that we like. You've got some real buildings underpinning the income. You got a tight housing market in the US. So there's demand for sort of high-end real estate in good places, New York, Miami, Texas. Even if the economy slows down, you still got to live somewhere. So we like those dividends that are coming out of something where you've got a tangible asset behind it and you have a management team which is committed to dividend and committed to growing it. Doesn't mean there aren't risks here. As I said before, leverage is always an issue. Those are kind of companies that we like. So we will have exposure to REITs. We have exposure to utilities. So we've got utilities in the US as well, long-term contracts underpinned by that. In Europe, we've got Vinci in France, which is the biggest owner of toll roads, bridges, airports, long-term concessions. Of course, here we got risks like COVID. We got risks like government intervention. Will they allow Vinci to put up the tolls on their roads? Yes, yeah, so in theory, with higher bond yields, some more income when we buy the bonds, and companies where the dividend is underpinned, our ambition is that the income grows over time from both bonds and equities.
Jacob, thank you for your time today.
Thank you.
That's all we have time for. You can check out the rest of our insider interviews on our YouTube channel, where you can like and subscribe. Hopefully, see you next time.